This conference will now be recorded.
Right. So the conference is being recorded. The first bit is by Stavros from BioSence Institute. He will discuss strategy development for digital innovation hubs. So digital innovation hubs are organizations with a very specific purpose, and Stavros will reflect on the use of strategy tools to help improve the working of a digital innovation. The second bit of the webinar will be executed by Alexander Berlin on behalf of the IOF 2020 project, and he will discuss some tools to support digital innovation hubs in developing strategy and business models. And in the second half, basically, of this webinar, we have two guests representing two different digital innovation hubs. The first one being the digital innovation hub Andalucia Agrotech. It will be explained by Judit and Ugarte. And we have the Transilvania Digital Innovation Hub, which will be explained by Bianca, Muntean. And the final bit is for you to discuss, to pose some questions and to discuss topics you want to have further clarification on. So maybe you can introduce yourself briefly. Oh, yeah. Bianca, can you introduce yourself briefly?
Yes, of course. Hello, everyone. My name is Bianca Muntean. I'm the coordinator of Transilvania Digital Innovation Hub in Cluj-Napoca, Romania. And I will be happy to tell you more about our strategy and our current status of development. Thank you very much. Looking forward for this interesting session.
Thank you very much. Going from left to right, Stavros, can you please introduce yourself briefly?
Of course. Thanks, Frank. Hello, everybody. Welcome. Thank you for joining. My name is Stavros Tsitouras. I work at BioSence Institute in Serbia as a senior project management. The BioSense Institute is a core partner of Smart AgriHubs and also a digital innovation hub in agriculture. And I'm looking forward to present you our findings here. Thanks.
Thank you. Judit, can you please introduce yourself?
Yes, of course. Welcome, all of you. And I'm Judit, and I belong to Regional Ministry of Agriculture in Andalusia region. And also, we are working in the Digital Innovation Hub Andalusia Agrotech. It's a tool for foster the digitization in the region. Thank you.
Thank you. Alexander, please introduce yourself.
Hello, everyone. I'm Alexander Berlin. I'm the business support leader of IOF 2020 and also the CEO of Berlin Thinking, as you can see down there. A lot of Berlin going on. We worked already 3.5 years now on IOF 2020, and there is a lot of knowledge and tools that came together. And today is the day we would like to share it with the Digital Innovation Hub. So looking forward for getting your feedback.
Thank you. In the back is Christina Karanikalova helping me out with the organization of this webinar. We have some house rules to be explained. Yes, the webinar will be recorded. That was announced by the system just yet for future reuse, huh, for people who cannot attend right now or want to review things maybe. The presentations will be shared via the portal after we finished for avoiding feedback loops. Please stay muted unless you are speaking and close the camera unless you are presented. So I will close off my camera in just a bit. You can pose some questions in the chat. We will, of course, be monitoring that. and try to answer them on the fly or in a discussion in the end of the presentation. So enjoy the webinar, and I'd like to give the word now to Stavros to kick off the first bit. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Frank. Thank you. Just one minor question before we start. Don't we have the Mentimeter as well to present to the audience or not?
Once we get to it, I'm going to explain it. I think it's easier when I show it on the screen.
Okay. Okay. So it's involved in the presentation. Okay. Excellent. Excellent. Thanks, Tina. So hello, everybody, again. My name is Stavros Tsitouras, as I presented myself earlier. So briefly, in the next more or less 15 minutes, we're going to talk about strategy development for digital innovation hubs. And even more specifically, we're going to attempt an introduction to strategy and its importance to digital innovation hubs. Of course, in the next 15 minutes, it's not adequate time to cover everything about strategy, but we will briefly try to cover as more aspects as we can. So let's start with the next slide by defining strategy. So defining strategy from concept to planning and implementation. So we already hear from the title, we already have three very basic and very important key keywords. We have concept, we have planning and implementation. Three basic steps of strategy we're going to see in more detail. But let's start with the concept. So how strategy can be defined? Of course, there are hundreds or maybe thousands of definitions out there. But let's choose one and say that strategy can be defined as the things that an organization will do to close the gap between its current reality. So we're talking about current situation analysis. And this actually includes market served, services provided, the processes, the people, of course, on all the stakeholders, the technologies, and very importantly, the finances. So initially, we see that strategy actually incorporates all the key elements that an organization should have a look at when defining the strategy. And this is the current reality, so the current situation, and its desired future state. So when we talk about strategy, we see where we're standing and where we're going to go. What about planning? Because we talk about planning. What is strategic planning? So now we have a concept of what strategy is about. What about strategic planning? So strategic planning is a management activity, organizational management activity that is used to set priorities and focus energy and resources in order to strengthen the operation and ensure that employees and other stakeholders are working toward common goals. This is very, very important. So when we define the strategy, it is very important to communicate the strategy towards the bulk of the stakeholders and especially the employees, and be sure that the employees can actually agree and follow, can actually serve a strategy and working common common goal, very important. And establishing an agreement around the intended outcomes and results of our strategy, if possible, of course, agreement between all this, the stakeholders, and adjust the organization direction in response to a changing environment. This keyword, again, is very important. We're going to see that in more detail later on about how the environment are changing, and therefore a strategy should change as well. So on the next slide, we continue with strategic planning. So what do we mean about strategic planning? Strategic planning should be a disciplined effort. So it should produce fundamental decisions and actions that shape, actually, and guide what an organization is, who it serves, what it does, and why it does it. Of course, with a focus on the future, as we said earlier. And of course, if we want to have a strategic, an effective strategic planning, we don't only have to see where the organization is going, but how it will go there and how and whether a strategy is successful. So this is the evaluation of a strategy, a very, very another important factor that we're going to see later on. And finally, about strategy formulation, which is the development of a long-range plan, usually 3 to 5 years. We're going to see that again later. For the effective management of opportunities and threats, as well as strengthened witnesses. Here, we have already a reference to SWOT analysis, a tool that we're going to again see later on. And usually, the strategy formulation includes the corporate mission, to specify achievable objectives, and developing strategy that setting policy guidelines. More or less, these are some key concepts and for strategy formulation and development. In the next slide, we're going to make now a connection between the digital innovation hubs and the strategy and strategy formulation. So let us remember what the digital innovation hubs are. Of course, everybody here should already know that, but it's important to remind some keywords here. So we have not-for-profit, one-stop shops that support companies, in particular SMEs, and public organizations in the digital transformation, offering them a plethora of services. We have here many key important keywords. So we have a not-for-profit organization, but with a potential customer base that it includes companies and public organizations, very important. And what is offered? Services. So the digital innovation hub actually offers services. And overall, the main idea is that the digital innovation hub should follow a structured approach in the context of its strategy development, which should be analogous and similar to what other organizations do. So we actually, as digital innovation hubs, I'm working at digital innovation hubs as well. Okay, so we take ourselves seriously. I mean, and we present and we implement a strategy based on standards from other organizations. The next slide, we have to see now what is the difference between a not-for-profit organization strategy and business-oriented strategy. If you do a search on the internet, you will see that there are two schools of thought, to put it this way. And they usually distinguish the strategy of not-for-profit organizations against the business-oriented strategy. So we earlier said that digital innovation hubs are not-for-profit organizations. So how we categorize in more detail a digital innovation hub? It's important to see how are we going to treat that in terms of strategy. So in the not-for-profit sector, when we are standing here as digital innovation hubs, we have two major categories. The first category is not-for-profit organizations that operate in non-competitive environments, usually governmental departments and government agencies. And we have not-for-profit organizations that operate in competitive environments. So not-for-profit organizations and so on and so forth. Among, again, these not-for-profit that operate in competitive environments, we can distinguish between organizations that actually charge for the services, like the digital innovation hubs, and organizations that actually provide the services for free for charities, NGOs, and so on and so forth. So based on this brief analysis, and on the next slide, we can actually ask the question, how we can treat a digital innovation hub when defining the strategy? So as we said, digital innovation hubs are not for profit organizations. However, their overall approach and mindset should be characterized by a strong business mentality. We're focused on business, even though we're not-for-profit, even though many digital innovation hubs belong, for example, to public universities or governmental agencies and so on and so forth. Our approach is that the digital innovation hubs should have a strong business mentality. Digital innovation hubs are and should actually charge for the services, okay, as we said. And digital innovation hubs have or should have a strong relationship with the industry, for example, SMEs. So these are the three cornerstones that we have to take into consideration. So therefore, how do we treat a strategy? How we draft a strategy for a digital innovation hub? Our perspective is that digital innovation hubs can be treated as startups and not as a public organization. And we're talking about startups because we have to be customer focused. We know that digital innovation hubs, most of the digital innovation hubs are the new founded organizations with 1, 2, 3, 4 years of life, maybe less. So we consider ourselves as startups. We are customer focused. We should be customer focused. And we also should be revenue focused. And what will be the overall target of a digital innovation hub strategy, at least for the newcomers? Overall, the main problem that we have been discussing with the other digital innovation hub is self-sufficiency. So initially, our strategy should be focused on how the digital innovation hub can be self-sufficient. This is the one and main important thing. And of course, how to grow in the future. How to keep the sustainability of the digital innovation hub, but how also to grow in the future. This is the mentality. Now I think that we have more or less a very clear idea of what strategy is and how, where to focus. On the next slide, I'm gonna show you two different approaches on the strategy development process. And because again, I will repeat, out there, there are again hundreds of different approaches of how to tackle strategy. But let's have a look at this first approach. This first approach is more or less a linear approach. So we have the present, phase one, which is called discovery. So actually, this is the current situation analysis. We gather information of where we're trending. What are we doing? The second phase has to do with the development of the strategy. The third phase, with implementation of the strategy. And then again, we have a fourth phase, which actually concerns the future. And it has to do with the measurement and the results of the strategy. So, okay, we implement the strategy, we have to see now whether it was effective or not. This is very important. We have to set specific KPIs, key performance indicators, specific financial projections, and so on and so forth. In the next slide, we have a similar approach, but it's not linear, it's circular, to put it this way. So in the middle, we have strategy development, and then we have again discovery, which is the current situation analysis, the thick strategic thinking. So we have to think where we're going to go, plan a strategy, then, okay, we do the strategy rollout, so we implement the strategy, and then again, we have a strategy tune-up. This part was actually missing from the first linear approach. So again, we come back and we see what works and not, but then we redefine our strategy. Things change rapidly. In the last period of time, the last year, we see what happened with, for example, with COVID-19 crisis and so on and so forth. So now, nowadays, strategy development is, I have to put it, is a living process. Back in the 90s, for example, when we were talking about strategies and drafting strategies and business plan, we used to draft like 300 pages business plans and strategic plans that actually stayed in the drawer and nobody looked at them ever. So this is not the case today. We have to adjust our strategy based on the current situation, and this linear approach, I think, it's more relevant than ever. On the next slide, we have to briefly have a look at what a strategic development plan is. So the three questions that we have to answer is what it contains, where it can be incorporated, and for how long do we plan. So basically, a strategic plan includes a vision and mission statement that sets an ambitious goal. So this is a very overall description of what we're doing. A list of initiatives, for example, product services, launches, geographic expansions that the organization will carry out. So what are we going to do in the pursuit of our main goal? And of course, a very, very importantly, the conversion of this initiative into financials. So everything that we do has a financial impact, positive or negative. We can never forget about numbers. I know people don't like numbers, don't like making financial projections, but still, it's something that needs to be done. And so where can we find the strategic plan? Here, in my experience, we have two routes. The first is that digital innovation hub or an organization can have a standalone strategic plan. And the second thing is that it can be incorporated in a digital innovation hub business plan, so it can be part of. Usually, this is the case. But nevertheless, there are other paths. And for how many years do we plan ahead? Usually, the strategic plan, it's 3 to 5 years ahead. But as I said earlier, we have, again, to constantly see and retune our strategic plan. So, on the next slide, okay, please. We had a question for the audience then. Okay. So the question is, Pristina, you will now explain how we can answer the question. Okay.
So you can just go to menti.com and use the code 713147, and you would be forwarded to the question here. And this is to find out whether your digital innovation hub has written a strategy document so far.
Okay. So I guess we can wait for
a couple of minutes, just a minute or so, hear about them.
Okay.
Still don't see people joining. It is very easy. You can just go to menti.com.
Menti.com, yes.
You can do it on your phone, you can do it on your computer.
Yes, maybe it's a good idea, Pristina, to write that in the comment section as well, the website and the code, so it's out there for people to... okay, now we're starting to get some. Excellent. Okay. Good.
Pristina, somehow the screen is not fully visible.
Yeah, true. Yes, you cannot see the code actually. Okay, now we have a 50-50 result. For me, to be honest, I would expect that most of the people wouldn't have written strategy document, but for me it's a pleasant surprise, to put it this way. Okay, now it's time to get back. Okay, nice. I think that, Pristina, we have an indication. It's more or less 60-40. I mean, no and yes. So maybe we can move on to the next slide. Okay. Okay, excellent. Yeah, thanks. Okay. So the next slide includes seven elements of a strategic plan. Again, this is one approach. As I said earlier, there are hundreds of approaches, but more or less briefly to go through this, you have the long-term goals, the year objectives, the action plans, the vision statement, the mission statement, the values of the organization, and some tools in order to validate that. Here, the proposal is a SWOT analysis. This is one tool. The next slide, for example, we have another strategic plan process, which is relevant with the previous one. Again, it's a linear approach. Okay, so we gather here the facts. We elaborate SWOT analysis. Here again, this tool. We review the inputs. We do a strategic matrix. This is another tool. Okay, the use of SWOT analysis. We define the strategies and we review and adjust the strategy. Very important. So, on the next slide, there is a presentation of some of development strategy development tools. As I told, there are hundreds of tools available. For me, in my perspective, the utilization of tools, they have a twofold person. We can use them as to incorporate them in our overall strategic or business plan, so it can be part of our plan. Or you can use some tools as a standalone tools in order to draw useful conclusions for specific situations. You can see here a list of tools. Of course, I'm not going to go through all of them because there are more of them. Just on the next slide, and because our time is almost done, I think, you see here, for example, the SWOT analysis. Okay, I think that everybody knows that. Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, threats. It's useful to say that we have the SWOT matrix, for example, that it's a very, very good, how to put it, add-on to the SWOT analysis, where, for instance, we combine the strengths with opportunities, weaknesses and threats. So we use the SWOT analysis and the matrix to draw most useful conclusions. In the next slide, we have the balance scoreboard. It's another tool that it actually implements a vision and strategy based on four major approaches, which is the financial perspective, the internal processes, the learning and growth perspective, and the bias perspective. And another tool, another example of tool in the next slide, would be the PEST analysis, which we take into consideration political, economic, technological and social factors. This is just some examples. And so based on that, there is another question then for the audience. And the next question is, have you ever used any strategy drafting tools? Yes or no? Of the tools that I mentioned, tools that I didn't mention, have you ever used any of these? So we can wait like for 1 minute to have answers to that as well. Thank you, Frank, for putting the... Excellent. Well, now, you see, now we have, this is very interesting, because now we have so far 15 yes and 8 no. So, but on the other hand, on the previous question, when we asked whether there is a written strategy document, more of the replies were no. So it's very interesting actually to discuss when we finish the presentation, how, why this happens. I mean, people use the tools, but they don't use them to record the strategy. It's let's keep that in mind for the discussion later on. But for me, it's very, very interesting. 28. Okay. I think that we got a very, very good indication. So next slide, please, and to move forward to the end. So as a conclusion to what we said, so setting up strategy of a digital investment hub should be a structured process. Should not be an ad hoc process. We have to take that seriously and communicate that to everybody. We have to set clear strategic goals, okay, whatever this can be. We have to see how we can reach these goals. And we have to communicate these strategic goals to all stakeholders, internally and externally. We have to implement the strategy and evaluate the results against specific KPIs and fine-tune the strategy. We have to take to consider digital investment hub as a startup, as we said, and the strategy should always be adjusted based on the current situation. And last but not least, as I said, there is a huge number of tools and resources available, both of course in our website and overall on the internet. And my advice, to put it this way, is to see what better fits your overall mentality, what you seem to work, and the needs of the organization. And to finish my presentation and to help the discussion overall, we have a final question for the audience, okay, which is, what strategic goals do you have for the coming years? For example, do you plan to obtain more customers? Do you plan to design and launch new services? These are some examples. So please feel free to share your opinion. Become self-sustainable. Yeah. New services. And ability beyond current funding, promote digital transformation to agree a serve view and agreement among the digital participants, to build an action plan. Wow, Christina, one question, can we hold this, can we actually see these replies after with the discussion part of the webinar?
Of course, we can show them, yes.
Okay, excellent. So that's all from me. Thank you very much for your time. And sorry if I have 5 minutes more than planned. We can keep that for the discussion earlier. Thank you very much.
And I would like now to give the word to Alexander.
Perfect. Thank you very much. I would just take over for a second because I'm always more familiar if I have the presentation here on my side. So hopefully you can see it. Christina, is it on the screen?
Yes.
Perfect. Awesome. So warm welcome to everyone also from IOF 2020 side. So this is the first step of collaboration between us and also the Digital Innovation Hubs. And as you know, we already running now since 3.5 years in IOF, and we're actively building already a kind of small digital innovation hub in a way with IOF. So you can see in the last 3 years, we worked on 33 use cases, developed 65 different IoT solutions, validated them in 140 different test farms all over Europe. So, and we had to obviously develop and support our businesses quite a lot. And now that we're ending and we're coming, let's say, to the learning part of the project, we are actually refining a part of our knowledge into tools that the Digital Innovation Hub can use. One side, obviously, to develop your own strategy. That's one side. So to develop your own business models, to develop your own sustainability strategy. And also on the other side, obviously, to use these tools to support your clients. So it means if a company is coming, you're setting up an innovation program, whatever you do, so that you can use them. And we worked obviously in different areas. So one is user acceptance. So we did quite a lot of work in questionnaires and so on in order to find out what people are actually thinking about that. So there's a few things on that topic. Then we have business model tools. So business model development in itself was obviously a key exercise. So that one is very important. And then we had the corporate innovation program. So that is a concept that we basically developed already last year and wanted to share with everyone in the event that was planned in Prague. And then suddenly the Corona incidents came around the corner and everything was canceled. But it's still there. It is a sustainability and business model idea that we would like to discuss with you, and that might be interesting. And then we have a farm to fork fitness program for our IOF 2020 use cases. But I think that might be also really interesting for you to think about how you can make your clients, your networks fit for the farm to fork and the sustainability goals of the European Commission. And then we have the KPI measurement and testing. So obviously one of the core things as well. We developed some standardized KPI approaches, developed the European Digital Test Farm Network, for example, based on our 140 test farms that we're having. So maybe also quite some interesting connections there for you to just access our resources and our tools. So now a little bit deeper into what we are actually planning with you. So now we're in this introduction and intro to tools call. We are offering you a little bit of a deep dive into these tools that I will present very, very quickly only today into presentations next week. You will get afterwards a little bit of a email from Christina, which gives you links to register. So that will come very soon. So if you want to dive deeper into a few tools, please let us know. And then the plan is to identify a few of your digital innovation hubs that are interested to work on specific tools with us further. Because none of them are all completely usable already. So there's still a bit of a, let's say, user acceptance testing cycle that we have to run through. And we would like to get a bit interested digital innovation apps that are helping us through that process and giving us the feedback. And then obviously the final goal is to publish these tools, make it available to all digital innovation apps so that you can use it and that you can actually offer even better services later on. So now a quick thing. So user acceptance testing very quickly is going to be happening a webinar on the 22nd. We have a feedback survey already developed, which is a very small one, giving you interactive ideas with your end users, and a very deep user acceptance questionnaire, which is already built on quite a lot of research and literature behind it. So if you're interested, we are happy to share it. And then we have a collaboration with the project called Reach Out. They built a scenario-based campaign tool, basically, so that helps you to build UAT testing cycles. So that's really interesting as well. So if you're interested in user acceptance testing, then please join this part. Then we have a business model toolbox, as I said. So that's composed of a business model component builder, for example. A business model visualization part. I will tell you a little bit about that. business network visualization, and obviously some normal templates that we developed here, canvases, a classification of readiness of use cases, for example, if you have one, things like that. So that will be obviously also made available in the innovation portal, I think later on, as documents from our side. So that's that. And then we have the innovation a program, a corporate innovation program. So that one is basically the idea of it's based on the needs assessment that we did internally in IOF with our companies. So because we have 140 partners, of which we have very large companies in there. So CNH, Kvenaland, Grimme, but also farm management provider like Agricolos, 365 FarmNet, and so on. And we also ask them what kind of needs do you have that a digital innovation app, for example, could fill for you. So especially we don't see so much activities in innovation programs from some companies, especially that are, let's say, medium-sized. And what we identified was that they have needs like platform building, community building, identifying partners for joint data ventures, sourcing new solutions, obviously, to becoming part of their platforms and things like that. And we would like to see together with you, is there not an opportunity to offer all together as a kind of a network of digital innovation hub, these kind of services that you have here, visioning, product testing, and so on, in a kind of like a package format, and make that process for especially these medium-sized enterprises, first of all, a little bit more affordable, but also more tailored to their needs in terms of geographies, but also in terms of services they need. So that's something that we would like to discuss with you and see. We have a few business model ideas there in the background, so happy to share that with you. And now some short insights into the business model toolbox again. Just very quickly, this is the component builder, for example. So you have different components, which shows you then the pro and cons, for example, shows you examples where these business models were already used, and get you obviously inspired with new business models that you might want to apply. We have one tool which is called the Data Scouts one, where we're mapping the data, the ecosystem. So we're mapped the IOF 2020 ecosystem and already some innovation players in that field. And it helps you obviously to identify maybe new partners or your clients to identify new partners, but also to monitor trends that are ongoing in the industry in order to find interesting topics that you might want to also dedicate your support services towards. So quite an interesting thing. We're also diving a bit deeper into that one in a specific presentation. And then we have a visualization part, basically. So here we're working with designers that are developing a bit of a modular system of visuals that help you to visualize the agri-food business model related aspects. And then to put it together into a more complex visualization of a specific business model at the end. This helps very often if you want to communicate your business model at a certain point to a client or a partner. It helps to have a kind of like a visual behind it. And we thought, okay, if we're creating it already in IOF, then it makes sense that you guys are getting access to it as well and reuse it in your circumstances, either for your digital innovation hub business model or for the business models, obviously, of your clients. And then we have the Farm to Fork Impact Program. So here we're actually working on interactive sessions with our use cases in order to train them and see together with them how impactful their solutions can be in terms of sustainability. We're following there the SDG classification, basically. So working towards, which is also the basis, let's say, of the Farm to Fork Program and the Green Deal strategy of the Commission. And that is basically a framework that we already developed, or basically our partner 2030 Cabinet developed that. So if you're interested in offering also these kind of services in your digital innovation hubs, going more into sustainability, offering workshops in that direction, we're very happy to give you some insights into our program, and maybe we can agree on some kind of train the trainer sessions or whatever if you're interested. And then we have the KPI measurement and testing. That is obviously one of the key parts of IOF 2020. So we validated all of our tools at least on 4 to 5 test farms each. So there, obviously, we developed common test procedures, which is quite complicated in agriculture, obviously. So comparable KPI sets, for example, but also SDG KPIs. And now our goal is a bit to merge that into EDTFN, a European Digital Test Farm Network. And if you're interested in that, learning a little bit more about this, happy to connect you. And there will be a webinar coming a little bit later in the year, not next week. This will be rather coming in September, when we're a bit further down the line with the development of the EDTFN. But I just wanted to let you know already that that's happening, so that you, if you're interested, that you can already raise your hand and let us know. So the next step would basically be that if you guys are interested in developing some things further with us and giving your constant feedback on a few of the tools that we're having here at IOF 2020, we would like to invite you to the three different webinars that we're giving next week. It's very short notice. We know we will record all of these webinars, so all this information will be made available if you cannot be joining. There will be Eventbrite links being shared with you after the presentation. Or after the webinar ended. If you register there, you can register actually as two different versions. You can register as a digital innovation hub that actually really wants to join, so that you have time and you can really actively be in the webinar, or that you're just interested in that specific topic group, because then we will still follow up with you on with some information and maybe some later workshops that we're preparing there, so that you are just kept in the loop. That's the one, so there's more information coming around with that. And now towards the end, a very short collaboration roadmap, let's say, to summarize what I just told you about. So today we are here on the 18th of June, giving you a little teaser of all the different tools that we're actually having, followed by the three webinars that we will have in the week from the 22nd to the 26th. So on the, basically from the 22nd to the 24th of June. Then we will have one more webinar, I guess, in July. It's not yet 100% fixed when we will do it, to present you the Farm to Fork fitness program, because that is also already quite far developed. So that will be coming. And then we have basically, we will choose some 1 to 4 digital innovation hubs, basically, to get on specific tools with us through some feedback cycles and some workshops, maybe, if you're interested. It would be really nice if you could support us there. And the idea there is you make use of our tools, we give you a little bit of insight how to use them, and you give us feedback on how we can actually improve them, how we can develop them forward to really be of value for your later work as a digital innovation app. And then, as I said, one later webinar then on the EDTFN and the KPI measurement part. And then hopefully a good and rich publication in November towards the end of IOF 2020, so that you can make use of it, a full use of the tools in 2021. That's the idea. And now we have a few little questions prepared by Christina. Maybe you can take over the screen from us.
Alexander, will these webinars of next week be available online afterwards?
Yeah, we will share them with you, so that you can share them with the digital innovation apps, but they will be also online on the IOF 2020 website. We will share a link in the follow-up email that will be going around. There is a link in it. If you scroll all the way down, if you click on it, you will directly get to our education page, let's say, on IOF 2020. And you can see all the webinars that were ever given, and these webinars will be part of it. So, yeah, we already have a little bit of results already coming in, which topics are the most interesting ones and which tools. So there is topics and tools, so a bit maybe a little bit confusing. So I see already that business models is obviously the most interesting one for now. User acceptance, not so much yet. Even so, I can tell you it's a super important topic because it's basically the success of the tool. So yeah, looks already quite good. Thanks a lot for that very good feedback. We see ecosystem mapping is very interesting, obviously, for an ecosystem project like Smart AgriHubs. I think it makes total sense. and also maybe for you really interesting to understand the connections there, but it's very closely followed up by the visualization tools as well, and the components not yet so interesting, but very good. That looks already quite nice. Hopefully, Christina, you can share this with us at the end, the results a little bit. That would be really interesting to have.
Yes, and I can share all the results with you.
That would be great, yeah. And then which of the upcoming specific webinars on these three specific topics are you going to join, maybe? That's obviously maybe for us a little bit of an idea of who can join actually already which webinars. So right now, it does not look very good. But at least a few people already coming in. That's good. And we will see that in a way. Just give us an idea for now, but you can already decide, obviously, later on in the book and register through the links that we will share. But at least
maybe
we're seeing that
we mention, maybe it's important to mention, Alexander, all the registered participants for this webinar received an email approximately 1 hour before the webinar already with the links. So if you're interested, go ahead and register, and we're also going to share these links again after the webinar when we share the materials. But just so you know, register so that you are aware of what is happening. Yeah.
Perfect. That sounds very good. So yeah, please be there. I think there's a lot of interesting things in it. It's an invitation. So let's have a look at what other tools. So that is now a little bit the question up to you to be a bit creative and come up with some ideas that we haven't thought of yet. But please link it a bit to IOF 2020. So what kind of things would you maybe wish for that IOF 2020 would share with you? Is it, I don't know, network contacts, whatever, that was not on the list yet. And we're happy to think about it and see how we can make the connections also in this side. So I don't know, maybe you're interested in some corporate contacts or getting some insights on our other KPIs. Thank you very much. Yeah, that is also one of our core value propositions, let's say, that we have developed in IOF 2020, because it was all about IoT validation. Product pricing models. So yeah, we're having some answers there. We're still experimenting also there with a lot of tools and with our solutions. So also there, the moment of truth is coming now in 2020, when our most of our solutions are going to market. Technology solutions, for sure. We have a good work package on that, which is also having quite a lot of reusable components. So my work package, so our reach out now comes from the business support team. So means that's why everything that you've seen is more ecosystem and business related, not so much yet technology related in a way. But I will for sure forward your interest in that direction as well, so that maybe we can also set up some transfers in direction of standards, APIs that we developed, actually some components together with Fiverr that we're actually setting up. Funding, okay, very interesting as well. Yeah, that's also an interesting one. We're also working on that one, so we're working there very closely with FNA Next and Eckfunder, for example, and a few of the larger investment funds to enable pitchings, for example, for our IOF 2020 use cases. So we're also having a bit in mind with the digital, with the Data Scouts ecosystem mapping tool that you just had a glance in the presentation, to see how we can use that also to guide the investors in a better way to make better deals. So maybe that is also quite interesting for you to connect. Reseller approach, yep, okay, that's very good. We're working on it right now. There will be a webinar coming up in July or August. The date is not yet fixed, but we're happy to share it with you as well. So it's dedicated obviously to the IOF 2020 use cases, but happy to share it with you as well. It will be going into the direction also of digital sources. So because now with the time of Corona and the physical events not being taking place, we had to be also a bit of inventive. and creative.
I'm sorry to interrupt.
Yeah.
I think we should move on to the next
Absolutely. Yeah. Let's go forward further. Thanks a lot for all your feedback. So we will discuss after the other inputs.
Thank you, Alexander.
And I would also like to introduce now Judit. Judit?
Yes.
You can present Andalucia Agrotech.
Okay. Hello, good morning, all of you. Thank you, Christina, Fran. First of all, I want to thank the SmartAgriHubs project the opportunity to present Andalucia Agrotech in this webinar. And what is Andalucia Agrotech is the first question. It's an European regional ecosystem that aims to accelerate a company and channel digital innovation in agri-food sector and its value chain. This tool was originated in 2017 as a result of dialogues amongst the agri-food, the ICT, and the knowledge communities. There was a clear demand coming from these communities and the Andalusia government, specifically the Regional Ministry of Agriculture, decided to take the lead, being the promoter of this digital innovation hub. Next. And where do we come from? This discussion of dialogues I mentioned before took place in the framework of the Smart Specialization Strategy and of the European Community we create in 2017 with the S3P Traceability and Big Data in Agri-Food Value Chain Thematic Partnership. We developed in this project a governance model based on the need of having regional nodes next to the regions in order to work together on the innovation process. These regional nodes are evolving into digital innovation hubs, and that was the case of the Andalusia. It is important to mention here that this evolution has been chosen by Joint Research Center from the European Commission as an example of ecosystem building. Next, please. Why are we doing this in agri-food sector? For us, for next, please, Christina. Okay. Yes. Yes. Because this sector is essential for Andalusia economy. Here you can see some figures to help you understand this. Andalusia is the second European region in agricultural productions. And we have more than 300,000 farms and more than 5,000 agri-food industries distributed in wide variety of subsectors, from olive crop to fruit and vegetables, from extensive livestock to greenhouses, or sustainable systems such as organic agriculture, and with great importance of irrigation. And also, this sector is very important for the exports and for the employment in Spain. Next, please. In this process, we are facing some typical difficulties of agri-food sector structures, of its diversity and the rural localization. And maybe you have the same circumstance in your regions. And in this slide, you can see some of them. For example, we have very aged farmers. Young people are not usually interested in this sector. We also have a majority of small farms, and there is a lack of digital culture. In general, the world sector gives very low importance to the data for decision making. And also we find out that most of the technological solutions in the market are not adapted to the agri-food sector. Also, we have insufficient data infrastructures and data interoperability. And also, the technologies still have a high cost for farmers. And finally, we also see that there is a lack of comprehensive solutions for agri-food sector. These barriers are, in the end, the problems we need to tackle in order to move forward the digital transformation of agri-food sector. Next, please. Which is our strategy? Taking into account all this, we pointed out some elements that now are essential for our strategy. We have a multi-actor approach. We need to gather the different capacities of our region to go for the most ambitious modernization of our agri-food sector. We now count with more than 100 members representing two ICT businesses, agri-food businesses, competence centers, and regional administration and civil society in this digital innovation hubs. Another element of our strategy is that the integrates all the interesting technologies for the sector in order to provide integrated solutions. Why? Because our agri-food sector is so varied and large that a unique technology or solution does not fit all. And of course, for us, we foster the use of data in the decision making. For us, it's very, very important. Also, the promotion of digital culture across the different levels, from farmers to technicians and specialists, as well as to the of dual training in agri-tech, is a key element too for us. Another, the D has to work on approaching technologies to the sector according to the different states. For example, in the first level is inspiration for those who still don't know anything about technologies, training for those who don't know how to use them, experimentation and piloting, and scale up and internalization. This helps us adapt our service to the different needs depending if they are less experimented or more experimented businesses. And we have crystal clear that our young people has to play a very important role in this transformation. They have new skills, capacities, and we need to be able to collect all this talent for this sector. And finally, this is a public-private open space of collaboration. The Regional Ministry of Agriculture, that is our regional government, is now promoting this digital innovation hub, but it is doing in collaborative and jointly with the private actors. Next, please. This is our best value is the cooperation. We think that innovation is not possible without cooperation. We have a global and international vision based on this in this cooperation. We are involved in different projects and networks like SmartAgriHubs. For us, our participation in this project and the regional cluster Iberia is being quite enriching for us. Which are our benefits? We can share experiences and knowledge with the community. We share similar needs as this is an agri-food network and a specific network for this sector. And we can connect other businesses, competence centers, etc. with others in Europe. And we can have common tools to continue on building our D and have some advice on our roadmap. In the next slide, for example, And that is the case of the maturity assessment, a tool that we have in SmartAgriHubs. We have already used it by doing the first self-assessment, and here you can see our results. It shows that we need to improve some aspects, giving us ideas of where to focus our efforts in the next years if we want to achieve our goals in our strategy. Next, please. And now I want to show now our current service. You will see how they are in relation to the barriers or problems we talked about before. In this service, it's very important for us, the digital skills. We believe we need to have a skilled and trained agri-food sector. And also, other need is to have living labs to develop pilot initiatives. In this sense, I want to mention the 5G challenge we have now open to agri-food sector with Vodafone company. And also about the use of data, it's very important to have open data service. And a lot of data being produced in our region by our public administration and other institutions are in this digital innovation hub. And also funding is crucial to be able to develop solutions. We are trying to stay turned on the different public and private opportunities, whether to promote them amongst our ecosystem. We have created a surveillance unit to identify strategic opportunities for all the community and for the Digital Innovation Hub. And also, finally, we are generating a co-creation space for all our stakeholders in order to facilitate the generation of innovation. For example, now we are working in a connecting program where we will launch 10 agri-food challenge. Well, it is an idea about the service that we have in this moment. And now the next slide is about this has been our progress since we started in 2018 as Digital Innovation Hub. We start in 2017 as a regional ecosystem or not. Currently, we are at the consolidation stage as a Digital Innovation Hub, and for that we have a budget of 1 million euros for the 2020-2022 period. And with this, we will cover the basic service of the DIF. And also, as I mentioned before, we are participating in different projects and preparing new proposals to provide new experience and skills to the sector. Next, please. And finally, and in relation to what I said before, I want to highlight that we are trying to take advantage of all of different funds and programs, not only European, but national and regional also. Regional too. Also, we have an special eyes on the different policies in order to be aligned with all those that are relevant for innovation and the agri-food sector in this moment and in the future. No more in my hand. Thank you very much for the attention. I have a video about this Digital Innovation Hub. If we have enough time, we can see it.
Thank you, Judit. I think we should continue because we're quite ahead of our time, but thank you very much for the presentation. If somebody has questions to Judit and how the Digital Innovation Hub developed their strategy, please let us know. I have one question for you, Judit. For example, what did you find most difficult when you were developing your strategy? What elements were more difficult to develop?
Yes. For us, the most difficult issue is working on a sector with a different running. At different sectors running at a different speed. For example, olive crop has reached a certain level of digitization, which is very different to the one achieved by vegetable, or for example, the different types of farmers. And also being able to offer a tailor-made service depending on the digital maturity of each agri-food businesses is also very difficult too. If you remember in my presentation, we try to offer different service according to where each agri-food business is in relation to digitization. They may be an inspiration stage, or maybe a testing one, and service change from one stage to another, in order to offer the most adapted ones to each agri-food businesses. Another element that is difficult for us is about the from the governance point of view, the internal organization of the Digital Innovation Hub to have a legal status is is not easy for us, maybe because we are a huge number of stakeholders and because it is difficult to coordinate the different private businesses with the actions for the digital innovation hubs. And we are now working in this area to improve this governance in the digital innovation hub.
Thank you very much for sharing this, Judit. And I saw that there was a question about your human resources and that already Jose has shared that you have about three people working in the digital innovation. Thank you very much. I would now like to also invite Bianca to share her experience in the Transylvania Digital Innovation Hub and how it started and what its strategy is.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for your invitation. Actually, we are not part of the Smart Agri Hub project, but we are part of the platform and we are following very closely your activities. And I would like to salute Mr. Viorel Marin, which is the Romanian partner in this project. So I will start by saying that, of course, the status of digital innovation hubs throughout Europe is not the same. Probably you know that at least in Central and Eastern Europe, there is a separate and a different situation. That is why in 2018, it was decided to by the European Commission and also by the European Parliament to run some training programs for this part of Europe, where to encourage the establishment of the digital innovation hubs. Actually, we here in northwestern Romania, in Transylvania, we found out about it during Open Innovation 2.0 conference organized in 2017 in Cluj-Napoca with the European Commission. Where also we had the partner as a partner, the municipality. Thus, it was easier for us to agree right from the beginning that Digital Innovation Hub is about an ecosystem. It's not about an organization. It's not about one entity, either public administration or private one, but it envisages an ecosystem. And what happened in our region, we have a very strong clusters established starting with 2012. So when we came up with this idea to establish the Digital Innovation Hub, we decided to build it and on the existing clusters in our region. Because what clusters did in the past 8 years, they built trust, trust with their members from different fields of activity. So it was a normal step for us. Then we participated, as I said, in a training program in 2018. We are part of the DIH Square, which is a network of digital innovation hubs offering cascade financing to experiments in agile manufacturing. And then in 2019, we have been recognized by JRC, European Commission, as a fully operational digital innovation hub. And last autumn, we've been selected for the DIH champions among the five digital innovation hubs in Europe. Starting this year, we also started to implement another Horizon 2020 cascade funding, in which we are supporting experiments from our region. And we are financing it to lump sums up to 60,000 euros. And also this year, in March, we decided to formalize our digital innovation hub by because we had a collaboration partnership among us with the clusters, but we decided to create a new entity, that entity being the next phase in our digital innovation hub development. Next, please. Of course, you all might know that the digital innovation hubs must be built on four main pillars, which are test before invest, financing opportunities, innovation ecosystems, and digital skills. And among those four pillars, four main pillars, we decided to have another one of strategic initiatives. Here, I listed a few of our projects, which we are currently implementing under the umbrella of Digital Innovation Hubs. And I must tell you that all this financing are through different type of programs. We are having structural funding, which is supporting the digital skills and trainings part in our hub. We are having urban innovative action for the test before invest part, where our municipality, for example, is creating a rapid prototyping facility and also infrastructure where we will be running experiments or Industry 4.0 and automatization. We are also working with the Enterprise Europe Network in identifying different financing sources for the digital transformation needs in our region. And also, we are activating under the umbrella of Transilvania Living Lab together with the municipality and other partners. Next, please. Here you have our current structure of governance. I'm also running the Transilvania IT cluster, which mainly envisages and deals with the IT companies from our region, universities and public administration. But as I told you, we are in the same boat with the clusters from Transylvanian Clusters Consortium. And we have the furniture cluster, Agro-Transylvania cluster, creative industries and the energy cluster. And actually, each one of us is taking the lead depending on the topic we are presenting at a certain point. So for agriculture field, the responsible actually to activate in this specific vertical is my colleague, Felix Arion, who is running the Agro-Transylvania cluster. Next, please. Okay, how are we working actually? Because speaking before this seminar on what I should focus on my presentation, of course, here in Romania, we are working very close with all the regions because now we are on the discussion with the public authorities in order to launch the selection of the digital innovation hubs, which will be eligible for the European Network of Digital Innovation Hubs. So how are we working? As I told you, it's not a history dating 3 years ago when we decided to put together our resources and to work all under the umbrella of the Transylvania Digital Innovation Hub, but it's a long, long history behind. And what we are trying to do is to put all the energies and the synergies together to identify all the resources and to come up with this strategy in identifying the suitable industries and also the potential the companies have for digital transformation in different fields of activities. And I'm happy to tell you that at the moment, agriculture is one of those fields. And we are working together and very close with the small and medium-sized enterprises and mid-caps, also from the point of view of solution providers, because we have a very, very strong technological pole here in Cluj-Napoca, but also in identifying the needs of these SMEs in terms of digital transformation. We are working with startups, which are offering very agile solutions, and we are identifying ways to support them in the ecosystem. Also with the academia and research, we are working for knowledge transfer using their infrastructure and their technology transfer facilities. The public administration, it was not an easy task, but eventually it became a normality for us in the past 3-4 years to work very close in our steps with the public administration, especially when we are speaking about the infrastructure, which is used for common innovative projects. The clusters are our engine, are the engine of our digital innovation hub, with their portfolio of projects, with their small and medium-sized enterprises, because they know very well their needs and they have a long history of working with the companies, public authorities, and also the academia. What it's new and it's a specific approach in our cluster is the concept of the Living Lab, where also we are putting this approach of the Living Labs as one of a way of doing our experiments in our region. And what we are doing, we are working, offering different support services downstream, as you can see, and also upstream, working in identifying new business models for the companies in our region, the type of values, and also promoting the Open Innovation and Open Innovation 2.0 conference, 2.0 concept, sorry. Among the technologies we are using in our digital innovation hub, we are currently focusing on artificial intelligence, big data, cybersecurity, blockchain, and high performance computing. Next. I listed here several examples. I know I don't have too much time left, only 1 or 2 minutes. So I will try not to refer in details to this project. This is our current business model. Speaking about the strategy development, we are working for it in order to submitting it for the national selection of European Digital Innovation Hub, but also for the European call, which is announced to take place at the end of the year. Next, please. We started to work with our public administration in designing their digital transformation strategy, and we are also involved in the consultative council for putting up the strategy. We are working also as a consultative body with the Northwest Regional Development Agency. And also, as I told you, through different types of sources of financing, here you have track project implemented by Agro-Transylvania cluster in the Transylvania Digital Innovation Hub. We are taking different steps in order to be closer and to bring closer the digital transformation concept and experiments and tools to the market. Next, please. These are some of our numbers from our past activities. As I told you, these are not activities started 3 years ago. We started more than 7 years ago to work on it. It's a process in gaining trust, in being consistent, and to be able to stay at the table to with different other stakeholders, and to create and to capture actually the added value for our region and for different sector of activities. So I think this is my presentation. On the last slide, you have my contact details. So for any question, I remain at your disposal. We are also responsible for coordinating the communication in Romania for the Digital Innovation Hub on the platform DIHnet. And at the beginning of July, we will be officially launching the communication and exchanging of information and knowledge between the DIHs among Romania and with the public authorities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bianca.
Thanks, Bianca. One question from me, from Stavros to Bianca, if possible.
Yes.
Yes, please.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. Thank you for a very interesting presentation. One very short question, because I was talking about the tools, models, etc. So the question is, what tools, methods, ideas, or whatever you found most useful when you develop your strategy and services at the Digital Innovation Hub? Can you give us an idea?
Yeah, we work a lot using entrepreneurial discovery process tools, design thinking tools. And what is important for us is not to create only from one team strategy, because we are speaking about different clusters, different stakeholders, different type of entities involved. So for us, it's important to have every angle and every point of view. So EDP is one. We are using the digital assessment and the improved digital quotient, in which we are analyzing the capacity and the appetite of digital transformation of the SMEs. So we are working with the regional development agency, for example, for the smart specialization strategy, also in their entrepreneurial discovery processes.
Excellent, excellent. Thank you. Thank you very much for the information.
Welcome.
Hello, this is Frank. I'd like to follow up on Stavros' question. So you mentioned you were developing strategy for different teams, and I imagine you are closely collaborating, because the organizations have some level of similarity. However, different, say, domains may require you to move in different strategic directions. How do you deal with that?
This is actually what I try to explain you, that, for example, for the IT sector, for the technological companies, we have, as you perfectly stated, different tools to communicate and to engage them. That is why the lead, when we are dealing, for example, because we will have an industrial approach and also a sectoral approach in our strategy, we are letting the clusters, each cluster, to take the lead when we are dealing with its part. I mean, it's a really close collaboration, but I will never go, for example, me coming from the IT cluster, I will not go and try to impose the tools we are using, but I will ask my colleague, which is the cluster manager from Agro Transylvania cluster, to speak the same language and to identify the appropriate tools in order to speak with his market, actually, and his area of expertise. So this complementarity between different stakeholders allow us to identify different ways of approaches in order to have the result.
Okay, thank you. We have a little bit of time, so if there are questions from our audience to Bianca or to Judit or to Stavros or Alexander, please ask the questions.
We also have one question from Sarah, and I think that maybe Stavros could be the first to answer, and then if necessary, the others can join. The question goes, when the strategy is developed, all identified partners agree on that they are going to be committed. What is the next step? What should be done to create a formal digital innovation hub?
Yes, I think that this question, thanks, Christina. I think that this question has not actually has to do with strategy, but has to do with the formulation of a digital innovation hub as a legal entity or as an organization per se, if I understand the question correctly. And to my knowledge, there is no official way in order to be a digital innovation hub in terms of organization. You need to register to a specific site, and you need to provide some specific services into the specific sectors, to my knowledge. So it's not easy to become a digital innovation hub per se. For example, you can become a Smart Agri Hubs digital innovation hub because we have a procedure, or our own procedure as a project. Frank, you can please step in if the information I'm giving is not correct so far. But I think this is the case, right?
That's right, yes. So from Smart Agri-Hubs, we don't have any, say, requirements. To the legal status, for instance, of the digital innovation hub. However, the European Commission, for their resources, does give requirements. And maybe Judit and Bianca can comment on your legal statuses and why you chose those. So in general, I think there will be stakeholders that would require an organization to have a certain legal status in order to be eligible for certain funding, for instance, or because of your background. So there will be typically stakeholders requiring you to be A or B. Please, Bianca and Judit, respond to this.
Yes, I think you are perfectly right, Frank. Actually, it's the same question as we had it at the beginning with the clusters, for example, what type of entity? Because we are speaking about the ecosystems. The ecosystem comprises of different organizations. And indeed, the European Commission requests that the digital innovation hubs have to have a non-profit organization. For us, the easiest way to do is to establish this NGO. For example, we do it by formalizing the consortium between the clusters member in the Northern Transylvanian Clusters Consortium. And the government, the structure of governments, it is decided among us. But indeed, as you previously stated, you have to have a non-profit scope when you are running the activities as a digital innovation hub.
Yes, Fran, in our case, for us it's important to achieve a legal status in the next year, because we think that a consortium isn't useful for all the functions that we can do in the digital innovation hub. So this is our objective, but we think that for us isn't easy because we are a large number of stakeholders, but we are trying it because we want that it's also very important for the sustainability in long term of this digital innovation hub. So we know that we must improve in this area.
Thank you for your comments. In the corner of my eye, I see that it's 3:30. So we have reached our time limit for today. Christina, are there any urgent questions in the chat? Otherwise, I think we can catch up with those later. I really do want to thank our guests, Bianca and Judit, for presenting their digital innovation hubs. It was really inspiring to see the differences and also here and there some overlaps, how you dealt with your environment and stakeholders and strategy. Thank you, Alexander, for introducing the suite of tools developed in IOF 2020. Next week, there will be follow-up presentations on the individual tools and piloting projects or user acceptance and processes going on. I warmly invite you to participate in that. And also thank you, Stavros, for shedding a light on the application of strategy tools for the development of digital innovation hubs. Thank you very much. I think this was a very fruitful webinar. Thank you.
Just one final comment. For us, it's great to be connected with you and with Smart Agri Hubs, because it's really important to bring all the information available for digital transformation under one source. So for us, it was a very, very insightful experience, and we will be looking forward to work with you and your partner here in Romania. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you as well. Thanks, Frank and Christina, for the opportunity.
And thank you all. We are going to share the presentations with the participants either tomorrow or on Monday, so you can find them as well as the recording. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much.